It's 6:02, and we'll bring this meeting to order. Meeting will be, East Texas Advanced Academy Board Director is in order, and I'm gonna ask Dr. Sullivan Willis to do the prayer, and then Ava Wellman's gonna do the pledge of allegiance as well. Please stand.
Let us bow. Oh, Father, we thank you for bringing us together for another board meeting. We thank you for each individual here. We thank you for their families, but we thank you most of all for our students. Help us to make the decisions that would benefit them, their families, the community. We thank you for those that had a desire to come but were not able to come, or we ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
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 Please join me in the pledge for the U.S. flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, and under God, one and indivisible.
Okay. Okay, Cynthia?
Yes, sir.
Do you have a curriculum report for?
Yes, I do. Good evening, everyone, again.
Good evening.
Summer school, we're in the process of planning for summer school. Dr. Stewart, Mr. Brown, and Ms. Burns is working on a summer school plan. And then we'll turn those plans into LISD so they could help us with the transportation, food and nutrition, the custodial staff, so forth and so on. This is our way of addressing the achievement gap, but it's also for enrichment. We're looking at those students, which we have a significant number of students are where they should be. And we're very, very fortunate considering what this community and this state and nation have been. And to have our students here at ETAA to be performing at the level that they are performing, and they are definitely on track to be successful on the STAR exam and other universal screeners as far as the reading levels of the lower grades. We're working with those children. So we're very fortunate. And I just want to thank the team, all of the hard work, the specialists, the principals, the time we've spent really going above and beyond helping our children. Lone Star Governance Training, Dr. Lord is offering the board training opportunity throughout, I believe, every Friday in the month of March. And several of these trainings are required by the state for every board member. They have one on March the 12th. You can either attend the 3 o'clock or the 6 o'clock session, and that's cybersecurity training. And then another child abuse prevention, and that's March 26th. You attend either the 3 o'clock or the 6 o'clock session. Questions about the Lone Star Governance Training?
Cynthia, if we're able to make those dates and those times, do we just contact you and you will set that up?
Yes.
At least?
Yes, I will set it up with Dr. Lord. Just let me know which of the sessions you would like to attend.
But we're really required to.
Required by state.
Yeah.
Required by state to have both.
Yes. That doesn't count for my other board training then. Probably start over here.
No, we're.
No, you could.
We're on the board. If you've taken those in the last year, then.
I have a lot of governance training, I'm just putting the others too. I don't know if we have cybersecurity.
No, I think you need to do the cyber if you haven't done it in the child abuse.
Child abuse, so.
Okay.
Training, but.
local outreach in an effort to help the city of Longview recover after the February winter storm. ETAA has partnered a local organization to help with their relief efforts, and our goal was to help them restock. And Brandon partnered with Highway 80, Rescue Mission, ETMPA with the Community Outreach Mission, Forest Park with J-Star Ministries, and Everhart with J-Star Ministries. And Johnson McQueen with the Salvation Army, Ware has partnered with the Longview Dream Center. And Ms. Burns at JMQ has a very unique idea, and I asked her, along with Community Outreach, to come and just talk to the board and share that with you.
Sure. So what we did is we partnered with the Salvation Army here in town. What they do is they provide free meals to families as well as a variety of other things. And so one of the things over kind of our snowman break that we had is that we saw kind of this viral video of a bunch of cereal boxes in the halls of a school that were lined up similar to Domino's. You push it over, all the children were able to watch it. And so we were kind of inspired by that. So we partnered with Salvation Army to raise, to get donations of cereal boxes. Students brought in donations of cereal boxes because we wanted to see how many we could get. And then today was the last day for kids to bring in their cereal boxes. And as of today, we raised over 1,015 cereal boxes.
That's
so we have cereal in rooms, stage, everywhere. And so all this is going to culminate tomorrow when at 1 o'clock we're going to have all 1,015 cereal boxes lined up in the hallway of our school. Our kids are going to be out in the hallway so they can watch, and then we'll have just one person push over that one cereal box, and then they're all going to come tumbling down. And so we correlated with some of our IV action and key concepts, which is causation, and just how one simple act, one donation of a cereal box, how it can impact our community or impact us in such a major way. And so that domino effect that we're going to see tomorrow is going to be a great visualization of what they've been doing for the past week and a half of collecting cereal boxes. So I'm so proud of our students and of our staff. They really came together to make this a huge hit. So tomorrow at 1 o'clock, if you guys are interested and you're free, come on out to Johnson McQueen because we'll have cereal boxes everywhere. We're going to video it as well. It'll be on Johnson McQueen's Facebook as well as Longview IC is also going to stream it on Facebook as well. So if you can't be there live, you'll be able to see it through video. So we've kind of posed some problems with, as of yesterday, we had over 800 boxes. So over 800 boxes, we did a test run of about 30 boxes, and we'll take up about 29 feet. So how, you know, how long is at the time 800 boxes? And then we timed it, we pushed them over, and we said, you know, if it was 32 boxes, we'll take about 8 seconds to push over. So how long will it take for 800 boxes?
Well, now we're at 1,000.
Yeah, now we're at 1,000. So you know, it could be.
They got the ramp here.
Yes, we're going to be going down the ramp.
Okay.
We tested it out. We want to make sure that all students can see as many vantage points of that long line. We're going to have them all lined up on the ramp down towards the fourth and fifth grade hallways. It's going to be fun. The kids are excited. The teachers are very excited about it. So I'm very proud of the work they did.
Very creative.
Yes, thank you. I'm looking forward to seeing that. March the 1st is now Girls in STEM Day that the state of Texas has recognized, and it was a result of House Bill 3435, and the legislation encourages schools across the state to embrace programs such as science, technology, engineering, math, and emphasizing women in those STEM-related careers. And I thought about this when it came out because 2 years ago here at Forest Park, we started out with Girls Power, Girls in STEM Club here in Forest Park. So we were already ahead of the game in terms of trying to get our girls involved in these types of career, pique their interest in these types of careers. So now it's official, it's across the state, it's March the 1st. Mask policies, there's been a lot of talk about that in the news and all types of medium, but the district, Longview ISD, will continue to recognize continue the COVID-19 procedures that previously been in place. And until further notice, I'm asking the board, the ETAA would also support that stance for our network as well. STAR testing, we're gonna move forward. The state is gonna give the STAR test, but they're still debating whether or not it's gonna be for diagnostic or will it be summative this year, because we'll see. But we're still gonna give STAR to every student, and we know that our remote learner has an opportunity, if their parents choose to opt out, they can do that if they refuse to bring their child here to school, or we can offer an alternate site. I'm working on the numbers across the network to see. We had our first simulation practice start today with fourth grade and seventh grade writing. So we'll get that data back in terms of how many of those remote children, families, opted out not to bring their child to school. And is that a good indication that they're not gonna do it either on the actual STAR day?
Do you have the dates of the different STAR tests?
Yes, ma'am. The first STAR.
April 6th, 7th, or 8th, one of those.
Okay.
Early April. And then the
writing STAR is on the 6th.
On the 5th.
Writing on the 6th. Mm-hmm.
And then grades 3 through 8 for math reading, and then fifth science, eighth science, and social studies will be in May
11th, 12th, and 13th.
And what's different about that, prior to the pandemic, eighth graders and fifth grade reading and math would test along with the fourth grade and seventh grade writing. And those are called SSI grades, and they get a second opportunity if the students who did pass the first time to take it the second time in May, and it determined whether or not you'd be promoted to the next grade. But this year, they're not doing that. So those fifth and eighth grade students will take it along with all of the other grade testing grades, and they get one shot, and it does not determine whether or not you get promoted. Also, there's some upcoming legislation regarding tutoring on campuses, so ETAA, we're keeping our eye on that and see what that's going to be about. But I do know there's talk in the legislature about tutoring, and I don't know if they're going to set some guidelines, what it's going to look like, make it mandatory, I don't know, but we do know there's some legislation about that coming soon. And as soon as I find out, I'll inform the board. Enrollment across the state is down 3% from where it was in October 2019. And more than half of the 3% of the students that we lost in enrollment across the state are from early childhood education, pre-K, or kindergarten. And the enrollment in mandatory grade levels 1 through 12 has only been reduced by 1%, because as we know, pre-K and kindergarten is not mandatory by law. And that concludes my report. Any questions?
That encompasses your culture conscious campus.
My culture conscious campus was Miss Burns.
Okay. And then we don't have a representative of district here for superintendent update. Then we'll move on to the consent agenda. Can I get a motion for approval of the regular minutes?
Make a motion.
Motion by Sel, second by Ava. All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed? Okay, do we have any donations else about?
No.
And city bank savings cards, have we got those taken care of?
Yes.
Can I have a motion for approval of bank signature cards?
Make a motion.
All in favor, raise your hand. Okay, for the Lone Star Government's time tracker, may I have a motion?
Make a motion.
All in favor, raise your hand. All right, we'll move on to our action agenda. We have in A, we need a motion for approval of Forest Park furniture purchase. Okay, got a motion by Ava.
Second.
Second by Sel. And we do have some discussion. Can you kind of explain that to us, some city?
Yes, these are funds from the MSAP grant. And I think this is what's left over from all of the MSAP funding that Forest Park has received. And the furniture is more innovative furniture for the students here at Forest Park. As you can see in this library, this was funded through MSAP funding. And we started this a couple of years ago with some of the classrooms, and now we're going to complete this. Basically, just about all of the other classrooms will be completed with innovative furniture for movement, furniture for students who may come with ADHD and they got to move around furniture where, you know, you may have to stand up. You learn best that way and you focus better. So that's what's going to be in these classrooms.
There's no more discussion. All in favor? Okay, 3-0. And on section B, discussion and appointment of a new member to our board of directors. I'd like to table this until we have a full board here next month with, since our president's out. Can I have a motion on that?
Oh, we have a discussion after the motion is made.
Do you mind?
Yes. Can I make a motion?
Okay.
Second.
Okay, so discussion back.
Yeah, only reason I mentioned having a discussion is our prospective board member, he's with us right now.
Sure.
Pastor with Darian Brown, out of formality, so kind of tabling it for our next meeting. But this is something that I'm looking forward to. And we're pretty well aware of his quality. So I did want to make mention of that, even though we're tabling it right now.
Okay. Well, we can, you know, if it's the board's pleasure, then we can vote down the motion and go ahead and have out.
I'm fine either way. So, I can do this.
We've kind of already, we've board if you'd like to do it.
What was that about?
Someone's gonna withdraw his motion. Okay, so, we can, proceed with, voting on the motion, motion B, if I can get a motion to approve section B. The discussion possible appointment of a member of these types, would you like to make that motion?
I make the motion.
Okay.
I second.
You second it, all right. Then, all in favor of, the appointment of, Ladarian Brown to the East Texas Advanced Academy Board of Directors? Okay, so we had, so that's three of them. Reverend Brown, would you like to approach it?
Sure.
Not much for rowdy here. Congratulations, welcome to the board.
Well, thank you.
We have a new director for East Texas Advanced Academy. Reverend Brown's a well-known figure in this town, getting more well-known all the time. And, we're looking forward to his input on the board.
Glad to be here.
Congratulations.
Have a seat.
Let me get my.
Now I'm not the newest one.
Okay, Donald, you can tell us about the money.
All right. Good evening.
Good evening.
Just to kind of run through with you, where we're at, I'd like to point out real quick at the bottom of the, February 2021 column on the page, you'll see, the number is about 17.9 million. That's what's been spent thus far through six months of our 12-month fiscal year. And, if you look on the other side, you'll see that 18.6 million, that's what we have left remaining, to spend out of our budget for the remainder of the year. I'd also like to point out that that includes those expenditures that we have for all of the technology and all of the PPE that we purchased at the beginning of the year. So we kind of had some front-loaded larger costs than we would see at this time of year because we made a wise investment at the very beginning, to really protect the staff and the students as much as possible with what we could purchase while still being innovative in getting all of the technology. There are still a lot of districts around the state that are struggling to get what they need, and we haven't. So, our kids are doing really well in terms of what we've been able to provide, and that includes all of the additional hotspots that we bought. So again, we took on a very large upfront cost to make sure that we could get the items when we could get them. And so now that we have them, what we're looking at is, once again, as we've said several months, it's a pretty healthy budget that we've passed. The hold harmless has been going, has moved into effect for the rest of the school year. Originally, it was just for the first 4 or 6 weeks. However, now it will last through the rest of the school year, provide some economic relief for school districts. What that means for us is that the budget that we've planned here should be the budget that we arrive at, because attendance is up for the students who are enrolled. However, we did lose some students in terms of that attendance, but some overall students, we did lose some in pre-K and kinder, of course, in the biggest areas, like what we saw around the state. But what that does is the hold harmless gives us the ADA for those students as we continue to track them down. As long as we meet one major qualification, that there are more students today in our buildings than there were in September. And there are more students today in on-campus learning than previously. We're at about 89% now of all our kids are on campus. So we've gone up, but we started the year pretty strong too, in terms of students being in the building. And I think that's because of all the precautions that we took at ETAA, really trying to protect all the staff and the students. So overall, it's going very well, it's very healthy. By the next board meeting, we should have the audit completed. As we stated in the last one, we've been able to get them much of the information that they need. There's still just a couple little components, but they are doing this fully digitally. So it's really neat to see how they're able to do a full audit digitally. And what it requires, Ms. Mary and I had to scan over thousands of pages of documents. So we've been, this poor scanner over here has been used quite a bit, and the one in her office, so that we can make sure to get them what they need. But it's going very, very well. Again, we are in a very fortunate situation that because our auditors also work with the district, SB 1882 is so very unique that it's very difficult to find auditors who can actually work with those partnerships. And so we kind of helped coach through our auditors, and now they're being requested by other school districts. They just don't have the time because of the amount of work it takes to do it digitally. But it's going very, very well in that regard as well. Any other questions?
Dr. Stewart, that settle of amount, is that's going to increase this?
Well, so the settle up amount is, it should be already accounted in this. The reason why it should be accounted in this is it's funding that's owed back to us, so it's in the overall allotment. But as Dr. Liza is speaking, there is a settle up for the management fee that we're receiving from LISD, so roughly about $46,000 that goes back into the management for ETAA to help manage the campuses. So it's a fee that goes back in. There is another settle up though that typically takes place as we come through. We will know about June or July what that looks like, what that settle up's gonna look like. Because once there are no more days of school, the district will have earned all of the revenue that it would. We will know at that point what our attendance and enrollment was for the year exactly. And then we'll be able to get our program allocation because of that. So we should know that number pretty early this year. Last year, Mr. Jones and I worked really closely to try to identify what that would be, and it was pretty spot on. It was very, very close with the numbers that he and I went back and forth with all year. Working with Dr. Guidry, I believe it'll end up being very similar to the same thing, because it's math. The numbers are the numbers, they're multipliers, and once you start putting them in, as long as the data that you load is clean, then it'll pump out the correct information that we need. If I had to take a guess at it, I would think that what we've run with as a budget this year is very, very accurate to what we're going to end up finishing with in terms of enrollment, ADA, and all of that. So very, very accurate, very, very accurate for the most part, which is a good thing. Makes it a lot easier. Any other questions? All right, thank you, girls.
Thank you. I don't believe we have any executive session items this time.
Yeah.
So we're going to pass by the executive session. Discuss action on possible future agenda items, things that the board would like to see on the agenda. Is there anything here that you'd like to see on the agenda? Either. So no. I had one item sent here that I wanted to bring up, and I would like to see, I'd like to see us look into, for ETAA, maybe we can put it under PE, physical education, but I would like to see added to our fine arts. I'd like to see some dance. I'd like us to look into hiring a dance teacher, doing some, you know, combining that with your cultural conscious program here, and have some, get a dance teacher, do some cultural dance for our different campuses, and see if that's something that we could pull off in the ETAA. We've got a lot of kids involved in sports, and that come to school because they're interested in that. I think we could find a way to make them, to bring kids to school, get them interested with something that's a little different. We've got music, we've got sports, we've got other things. I think dance is something we could add to our repertoire, so to speak.
Yes, and presently here at Forest Park, we do have a dance group, I'm gonna call it. It's not a class. I think they tie in with cheerleading, but I can look into separating this and make it as one of the electives.
Okay. I think we've got the funding to manage it. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we can do something.
Steve would love that.
Okay. And so I'd like to see that on a future agenda.
Yeah. We did a survey of the students. Well, we did with the seventh graders, because there'll be eighth graders next year. 2 days ago, about their interest beyond Forest Park, So when they get to the high school, they would have some type of experience or background knowledge with the CTE classes, or is it CATE?
CATE.
The CATEs.
Very good.
And so we did the survey, we wanted to know what are you guys interested in? And so I believe most of our students here said something about graphic design, fashion, and marketing. About 29 of those seventh graders of 100, say 50, expressed an interest in welding. So we are now, you know, working with Mr. Brewer in the high school. He would like to see it just as an introductory course here. And so by the time they get to high school, they would have been exposed. So we can, you know, tie it in, right in with it.
I also think that would be really good, because a lot of those kids in our CATE program at the high school, they are actually getting certificates and certifications before they graduate. And so we have kids leaving an ETAA middle school campus, going to the high school, a little bit more prepared. I think that would help them to where they don't have to start at the very, very bottom level. They can actually be a step ahead their ninth grade year versus having to wait to their junior or senior year getting inside those certification
classes. Some of those kids can come out with $50,000.
Yes.
Correct, correct.
In high school, which is very supportable for your family. I have another question related to that. Are we teaching coding classes here? I know some of the other schools were doing coding classes coming off the board, but are we doing coding at our middle schools right now, or the elementary schools?
It was here at Forest Park. We didn't do it this past summer. They had a summer, Megan, you may want to speak to that. It was here before I got to Forest Park.
It was a Raspberry Pi program where students were building a computer and also coding. I know in some of the various elementary campuses, like at Johnson McQueen, we have robotics, and the students are learning coding at elementary campuses. Here at the middle school, we do have computer design class where the students are learning the different aspects of Google Suite. Then also they're moving into, there's a free program online, I can't remember the name of it. But I know Mr. Conrad, he works with the students on coding and just the various capabilities within computer design.
And I've seen some of the classes in Judson, they were doing a gaming class, which is a huge, very extremely popular Judson.
I can imagine.
So, yeah, so I got to see the bots when I was on the school board.
Yes. The OSA bot.
Joshua McQueen, the kids were phenomenal on that. I love that. And they were so excited. They said it was hard, but they were so excited, and I can see a bunch of those kids continuing in that. So.
And Jim Everhart has the Acellus Lab.
That's great. I think that's future career possibilities out there for our kids.
So I see some possible future agenda items in that, some maybe some work up for the board, what we're doing for career technology, to the kind of a preview for career technology, and maybe in this coding and in the welding, so that the board can keep in mind what we're doing and if there's something else we want to go on and do. So if we could get that on the agenda, then that'd be good. No further things there. We jump to open forum. I don't think there were any open forum cards for the message.
Yeah.
Okay. That brings us to the end of the meeting. We'll, if there's no further business, we'll stand adjourned at 6:37.